She was a child psychologist right after World War II, and she was part of developing the United Nations at the time. And she said, well, this is ridiculous because these adults, this is way too old, they already have their inborn prejudices, and it really should start with the children. And so she decided to start CISV as a camp where young children, and she, since she was a child psychologist, she said specifically they should be 11 years old in the latent phase of child development, right before they, you know, get into that genital phase where they're like distracted by that. But that latent phase where they're open to ideas, but they don't have a lot of preformed conceptions. So that's why she did that. And so this is an interview. Walter Cronkite did a special on CISV way back in the 60s. And this is excerpts from the hour-long program. And I always think it's fun to see this because it really takes you back.
Reporting. Today we present the story of some international citizens of the world, all of them 11 years old. They come to summer camps from many lands. They live together, they play together. They discover how alike they are, despite different languages, color, national customs. At 11, it is hoped they are old enough to know and too young to hate. This is our story, Too Young to Hate, as the Prudential Insurance Company of America presents the 20th Century. This is a children's international summer village in England. The villages were founded by a child psychologist in Cincinnati and by civic leaders around the world. Since 1951, there have been 48 such villages. 11-year-olds from 44 countries have lived together and played together for a month. We filmed them at children's villages in England, Germany, Norway, and at Long Beach, Mississippi, as they discovered that nations may be different, but people are the same the world over. Why are only 11-year-olds picked? We asked the founder of the villages, professor of psychology at the University of Cincinnati, Dr. Doris Twitchell Allen.
But now this age of 11, you see, is the age that comes before adolescence. And in adolescence, the person is busy with adolescence. It is notoriously a turbulent period, a period of contradiction, in contrast to the age of 11, which is a much quieter, more even, it is sometimes called a latent period because of its very quietness. The thing that children learn and that we want them to learn is how alike, basically, human nature is. But at the same time, if we want to live together in the world of all of these countries, a world of peace, we must feel at home with differences of culture. Therefore, you must have children who have some stamp of their own culture. And by the age of 11, the children have their own language that they use with facility. They have their own dances and their own table manners by that age. They have their differences of costume. Their rituals have taken on meaning by that time. So the children say at the end of it, oh, I have friends all over the world. And that's what we want them to feel.
Here in this village you may see children living happily, gathered from all parts of earth, sharing joys of countless worth.
The camps are small, so every child can get to know all the others. It doesn't take long for the initial strangeness to wear off. In a matter of days, there are only children, not countries, in 11-year-old eyes.
Oh,
At the Children's International Summer Villages, every country has a national day. This is Japanese Day in Mississippi. So far, some 2,000 11-year-olds have met and made friends at villages in Asia, Africa, Europe, and the Americas. Later, in their teens, they meet again at reunion camps. They hear from the villages by bulletin. They hear from each other by letter. Now, a flood in India, a train wreck in Japan, a revolt in Latin America may cause youngsters in Philadelphia, Oslo, or Paris to wonder, are my friends all right?
What did you think the camp was going to be like before you came?
Well, I thought there'd be a sort of road over there where we'd go riding along. And I thought there'd be a great big swimming pool. It's not exactly the same as I imagined, but it's smashing fun.
While I was in Japan, I thought the United States was full of mechanical things, everything automatic. But I found that the United States is like Japan because the USA has lots of woods and natural things, just as in Japan.
You and I should get together, we could have a party. You and I should get together, really have a party.
I'm going to talk a bit about the background. So I'm going to try to get some input because I feel like most of you already know quite a bit about CISV. So could someone read the mission statement?
CISV educates and inspires for more justice in peaceful world.
Okay, so there's one word missing from there that I noticed. Does anyone know what it is?
Action. Yes.
So here it's supposed to say action. So the idea is that, like, by bringing people from these different countries together, you plant the seed to do something. So that's why CISV isn't a volunteer organization, which is what makes it different, is that we're not actually going into communities and, like, making that physical difference, but we're inspiring people to go home and do that. So that's more what the junior branch does. After your program, if you come home and you really want to keep doing stuff with CISV, the junior branch is a place where you have ways to stay connected and stay involved for the rest of the year and actually do make tangible impacts in your community. And that's all youth-led, so it's about leadership for high school age people. These are the four content areas, and that's what the education of CISV revolves around. It's not as much about teaching kids a certain thing like you might at school, but about making them, giving them the freedom to explore these things and think about them without giving them the answers. Obviously CISV is volunteer run, it's nonprofit, non-political, non-religious, but there's certain things that we do try, certain values we try to instill in people. So one is we appreciate the similarities between people and value their differences. Which content area do you think that is?
Diversity?
Yeah. Could you read this?
Yeah.
explores the identity of the individual and then asks us to consider ourselves within our own and the wider community.
Yep. And then another one is, we support social justice and equality of opportunity for all. Which one's that?
Yeah,
could you read the description of that one?
Considers how human rights affect every aspect of our lives and how violations can lie at the root of problems such as poverty, violence, and lawlessness.
Mm-hmm. And then we encourage the resolution of conflict through peaceful means. Yeah, can you read the description too?
Help us to understand how conflict can arise deliberately or otherwise, and what can be done to help bring a peaceful resolution.
So what I think is really interesting about that one is that we always emphasize the and. It's not called conflict resolution, it's conflict and resolution, because it's recognizing that conflict is a very important part of learning and life, and there's not really any way to completely avoid conflict. It's always going to happen no matter what you do. So when it arises, we have to try to find ways to use it as a learning opportunity and find creative ways of resolving it. And especially like with kids, not resolving the conflicts for them like a teacher might do, but trying to encourage them to find ways to think about it and resolve it themselves. And so the last one is, we support the creation of sustainable solutions to problems relating to our impact upon each other and the natural environment.
Sustainable.
Yeah. Could you read it?
Yeah. Looks for integrated ways to promote economic and social well-being while protecting the environment through the responsible use of natural resources.
So this one has three aspects to it that we usually talk about if you're getting really in-depth about this, which is economic, social, and environmental. So it's not just environmental sustainability, which is what you usually think of as the main one, but also social. Like CISV itself is sustainable development because it's developing sustainable practices of raising kids to think in a way that's better for the future. So it could go a lot of different ways. And then each year, CISV International chooses one theme to be the theme of the year that most activities focus on, and most camps use that as their theme. Do you know which one it is this year?
Yeah.
Human rights, right?
Yeah. And the camps, your camp's probably gonna have a theme. They usually do like a silly theme and a serious theme that kind of goes underneath that. So at, like for example, one of my camps was 7 billion hearts was the theme, thinking that we have 7 billion people in the world, but that also means there's 7 billion hearts too. So it's not just like a burden of people, but it's also that many people that can make a change and make an impact. So that was kind of our silly theme. And then the serious theme, was it human rights, I think, that year? So then we tried to explore human rights that way through that vehicle.
Villages are a little more fun.
Yeah,
my
village
was,
Under the Sea?
Under the Sea, because we were near the beach, and so, you know, it was easy to do all this fun, you know, silly Under the Sea emo stuff, but then they could explore how diverse the sea is and all the creatures in the sea, and, you know what I mean, and get into that, yeah. So it was easy for the t-shirts and the fun posters on the wall, because we could draw fish and starfish or, you know, whatever, but then you could also make it deeper. And like this was like my Back to the Future was the thing, you know,
that was not too nice. Yeah, and when you're planning activities or helping the kids plan activities, if you're doing a step up, you usually choose one of these to be the focus for your activity, but of course they're not mutually exclusive. A lot of things have multiple ones or all of them that can be explored through an activity. So the way of learning in CISV is through experiential learning. It's usually not, like I said, like a teacher telling people what to do, but trying to get kids to experience things themselves. So usually the kids come from places where the kids themselves aren't experiencing poverty, because you have to have enough money to get a plane ticket or whatever, but they can experience those issues going on in the world by doing simulations, like a game of rich and poor, where some of the kids are rich and some are poor. And so they get to talk about these big issues and experience it themselves in a safe environment. So learning by doing is what we call experiential learning, so learning from experience. And the way we kind of visualize this is this little do, reflect, generalize, apply graphic here, which is also called Dr. Ga, to remember it. So do is you do an activity, say like a rich and poor thing. And then after the activity, a very important part of every activity that kind of makes it a CISV activity is having a debrief, so talking about it afterwards. And then you have people reflect on that. And the questions in the debrief are structured as reflect, generalize, apply. So reflect is, what did we do? How did you feel? What happened? Like very simple things. And then the generalize is, where do you see this happening in the world? Where do you see these issues coming up in your own life? So they can kind of apply those lessons. And then apply is going out usually into the real world and doing something about it, or saying, how can you make a difference about poverty in your community? And a lot of times the apply part of it doesn't happen until like months, maybe years later, when you're in some situation, you go, oh my gosh, this reminded me of that one CISV activity. And so an 11-year-old who doesn't seem to get much out of the camp might actually get it a little later. Another way we kind of think about what we learn here is through attitude, skills, and knowledge. So at your camps, you're probably gonna have a big chart where you look at which attitude, skills, and knowledge the kids have actually gained to kind of measure their progress.
That's called a PIDAPEF. Yeah. You'll all have it, and it's a thing that the director of your program will introduce you to, but it's an evaluation tool that we use throughout all of our programs. No matter what program you are going to, you have a PIDAPEF. And that graphic sheet, that page that Hallie's showing you, it's in your program guide or that you should have received from Vicki electronically.
Yeah, so attitudes is how you think and behave. Things like being open-minded or flexible, willing to include people. Skills are abilities to do stuff like communicate, be a leader, reflect on yourself, solve problems. And then knowledge is knowing things about populations and communities and environmental issues and stuff like that. And this little passport is very easy to get. We have tons of them flying around in CISV. So if you want one, it's a lot easier to be able to explain what CISV is to people, and also to remember yourself, to refresh yourself on all the things that I was just talking about. So it has the statement of purpose in here, the mission statement, the educational principles, the different attitudes, skills, and knowledge, what that means, the different content areas. And that little graphic kind of shows how they overlap too. And then, let's see. Kind of what a theme is and how that can help like connect to kids and help them understand what you're trying to do. And then the do, reflect, generalize, apply model. And for that, it says there's a quote from Confucius that kind of is the idea for the experiential learning, which is, I hear and I forget, I see and I remember, I do and I understand. So like that kinesthetic learning we were talking about is a lot more relevant to most kids to be able to learn.
Sometimes when you get into, you've got your program and you know what that, if you want to pass these around, you know what your program is, but if you're not really familiar with CISV, you don't know what all the programs are. So this is a very old handout, because you'll see it says summer camp instead of step up. The name was changed a number of years ago. But this gives you an idea of what all the programs are. So just to briefly touch, this is like whirlwind CISV, like instant CISV is what we're talking about here. Sorry. But the village, as you probably know, is for 11-year-olds, and that's they have 12 delegations from 12 different countries, so it's four kids and an adult leader. The interchange is when a group of kids from one country go to another country, and it can be variable numbers of kids. They usually have a leader, and if they have so many kids, then they'll have an assistant leader as well. The summer camp or step up is just a little bit older age group. It can be, I think it's either, is it 14, 13, 14, and then 14,
14 15, 16.
1415, they've changed it. And so in that program, the kids plan more of the activities. They are involved in planning the activities. In the village, the leaders are planning the activities. So in Step Up, the kids are involved in planning the activities, but the leaders are very active in helping the kids plan the activities.
And in Step Up, they also have the option, it's more like the camp is theirs. They can decide a lot of things. They can decide their bedtime. They can rearrange the schedule. They have a lot more control over stuff. So I think of Village as a lot more traditional. At Village, you pretty much always do the CISV song every morning and night. You do ketos after you eat. You do these like little CISV traditions where at a Step Up, the kids can say, actually, we don't really want to do lullabies at night. No one really wants to. Or we can make it optional. They have a lot more freedom to decide how it works.
Right. Junior counselors are in Village, and those are the 16-year-old kids that provide the energy for the camp, and it's a great role for kids who have done other activities in the past. And then seminar camp and youth meeting as well are similar. Youth meetings, usually a little shorter, are for older children and where the kids take total control pretty much of the camps. And so I directed a seminar camp last year. The kids decided what they were going to do, how they were going to do it. They did all the, they cooked their own meals. You know, they do everything. And the staff, are they don't have leaders. The staff's there to make sure that nothing bad happens, basically. And then on here also is Junior Branch, which is our youth group that happens year-round and is really cool. And all of you are invited to get involved. And Nikita was our president, was it just last year? And they do one or two activities every month, and then they do the mini camps in the winter, and it's really a very cool program. You'd be welcome to get involved. Mosaic can be a lot of different things. It's a local activity. It's applying the CISV ideas. So in the past, we've done something called Faces of Jacksonville, where we do a local work kind of village, where we invite kids from different communities within Jacksonville to do like a village here that we put on with just Jacksonville kids. We haven't done it in the last year or two, but we did it for a long time. It just takes a lot of effort.
Yeah, the main parts of that is it's a lot more like project-based and hands-on, so that's more going into the community and doing something. And it's supposed to be something sustainable, so like over a period of time, not just like a one-time thing. And another big part of that is working with a like-minded organization. So it's recognizing that we have certain strengths, but we also, there's a lot of things that we don't have and we don't do that other organizations do. So like working together to kind of build relationships and bridge those gaps. Acronym CISV stands for Children's International Summer Villages. But when it started out, that's all it was. And now it's not just for children. There's leaders, there's IPP, which is 19 up, so that's not children. It's not just international, the JV and is local and national. There's a lot of national stuff going on. It's not just in the summer. There's winter camps, there's youth meetings in the spring, and it's not just villages, of course. There's all these programs. So CISV officially has decided that CISV doesn't stand for anything. It is its own word that just means CISV. So when people ask you what it stands for, you're supposed to say it stands for peace education and stuff like that.
So this year, the official content area is human rights. So something that's really helpful is the UN, a really, really, really long time ago, came up with their official list of the 30 articles that define human rights. So I have it printed out, it's two-sided, all 30 of them for you. Whatever you're doing this summer, this is something you wanna have in your toolkit when you go to camp, because your theme is gonna be connected to human rights in some way, shape, or form. All of you, even who's Village here? Village, it's still the overarching theme for all of CISV. You won't have as much as like the step-ups and the youth meetings as far as that theme goes, but it is the overarching theme. So this is a list of 30 articles of human rights as declared by the UN.
I just went to Google and typed in UN Human Rights, and that's where I got this from. There is so much information there. So when you're meeting with your kids or when you're at your camp, if that's a resource you want to use, the UN website is really helpful. They did the same thing with sustainable development last year. So it's very similar to what they did last year with that. So I don't really have anything else to say about that, just that that's the overarching theme this year. We want to try to work that into, particularly Step Up and youth meeting, you'll want to work that into almost every activity in your camps, is the human rights theme.
I have found that it's one of the harder themes to make experiential and fun and interesting to be able to get the kids to connect to. And a lot of times it's hard for them to realize how human rights affect their lives. So a lot of times, like in an activity, people will end up like handing out this document to the kids and they don't really know what to do or think of it. And a lot of human rights activities kind of end there or become a little more academic. So a JV task force a while ago decided to make some like pre-made activities that could be done with any age group and could be formatted to work at any style of camp. And they're all free online. So if you get really stuck with activities, or especially in village where you're the ones planning the activities, you can use those. It's a really great resource. And they ended up starting with human rights because they wanted to show people a way to make really interesting, engaging human rights activities. But they also did it for the rest of the content areas each of the first 4 years afterwards. So the human rights one is called Right On. And the diversity one is called Branch Out. Conflict and Resolution is called Dig In. And I can't remember the sustainable development, but it's something similar like that. And where do you find it? I would just search on Facebook for Right On, and you'll find the page, and then they have those linked on the page somewhere. But it's also on like the international resource page.
For CISV?
Yeah.
On the CISV website, okay.
Yeah.
That's
if you know
I'm
the
right
name
on
and
here.
Search it, you'll find it eventually. Kind of what I do.
So Right On, Branch Out, Dig In.
Mm-hmm. And there's one more, I don't know what it is.
And Dig In is Conflict and Resolution?
It might be sustainable development.
I would say that's sustainable development.
I don't remember what the
Branch Out is diversity, Right On is human rights. So it's,
yeah.
it's
something for conflict.
So conflict and resolution is what we're missing. Okay.
Would you give an example of a very specific activity that could be done? Like that
sure.
You're
so some of you were there, maybe not, at the selection. I wanted to do one activity for selection that was more educational and kind of showed what the actual, like did something with the content area so the kids are like, okay, a camp isn't just playing all these kind of meaningless games, we do stuff with content. Do an example of a debrief to see how they interacted with that. So I didn't have time to plan some big activity, so I looked online and printed out one of the Right On activities. And the one we did was very simple. It was, we made a little kind of graph on the floor and had different labels for each of the sections of the graph. And it was, I think it was, on the top part it was in your city, in your country, and in the world. And then on the other side it was the freedom of expression, the right to vote, and then the freedom of movement, or something like that. So three pretty tangible, broad, human rights that people can usually relate to. And so then the kids got to choose which intersection they wanted, if they wanted to do freedom to vote in your country or freedom of movement in the world. And then they made groups by that, by choosing which of the two things they wanted to focus on. So it was something that they were already interested in, and then they had a little discussion, and then I gave them something else to talk about, and they had another discussion, and then we all went together and had a debrief about it. So it's something that you could do with any age group, with any amount of people. The facilitator can change the activity. I left some stuff out and added some stuff of my own, and then something else that the JV kind of wanted to do with this was have everyone take pictures and post them online. So then online you can see that same graph and those same topics being done by people in Hungary, in Japan, in New Zealand, in the US. And then you get the idea that by doing this one little simple hour-long activity at home, you're actually part of something bigger, like this global movement.
Okay, so this portion of training is about how to plan an activity.
You guys are going to have mini camp. So this is going to be helpful for you with your mini camp and you and your kids planning the activity. I'm not sure how old your kids are. How old are they?
14, 15.
So they'll be planning your activities, but you're facilitating the planning. Or are you doing the activities yourselves? How's that working? Either way.
We're going to have to both interchanges together. Like both.
Oh, okay.
Because mine is Sweden and hers is Prague, and we were going to have all delegations come together as like a big mini camp.
Nice. Okay, so at some point you're going to need to know how to make sure you freshened up on how to plan activities. This does apply to you guys. So village, obviously, you're going to be planning activities with the leader group. Step up, you guys plan, the kids plan the activities with the assistance of the leader. So it's a little bit, you're more facilitators, but you still need to know like the nuts and bolts of how to plan an activity. So first and foremost, we have the content areas. All of our activities are educational. Even though it looks like there's a fun running game going on, there's something underlying that they're supposed to be getting out of it. So at some point, the activities that you're planning need to be able to revert back to one of these or more of the content areas. So that's something to consider when you're planning activity. If you'll look, what I passed out to you, this page. Everything's two sides. Look at this page with me. You guys each have one. Look out of the pink bubble. Is on the back of this thing. Yeah, this guy. So this is all the things to consider when you're planning an activity. These are these three handouts are for you to take with you, to take with you to camp, to help you remind you and help you teach your kids, except for you, just to teach you and your leader group how to plan an activity. So things to consider. Where the activity is going to take place. Like Andrew said, always have a plan B. If you're doing a running activity in the afternoon at the soccer field and you have a hurricane, well, you need to have a plan B. So you need to consider where it's going to be. That's a Florida thing. Just Florida. I know Florida. So anyway, so you know where it's going to be, the time of day. You know, are you going to do a running activity at noon outside in Florida? No, you're not going to, because they'll be dehydrated. So the time in camp. Turn that page over, and you'll see what's called the time love stairs. You're not going to do a getting to know you activity at the end of camp. That's going to be at the beginning of camp. So if you follow the progression, it kind of gives you the types of activities you should be planning at different times in camp. So like your simulation games would be towards the end of camp when they know each other better. So this is a good guide to help you figure out the type of activity, whether it's a getting to know you, cooperation, you know, those kinds of things. So that kind of explains to you. Usually in the leader's lounge or the leader's room where leaders plan activities or where the kids plan activities, you would have a visual like this just to help them figure out, well, where are we in camp? Are they ready for a trust game right now? I don't know. So that's a thing to consider as well. Is the time and the level of the activity. Step up in particular, you have a theme. Your theme should always be a part of your activities in some way, shape, or form. It should be incorporated into your activities. I've given you an activity planning sheet. This one actually says, well, some of them say they're for youth meetings, some of them say they're for step up. They're all basically the same. At the it's a guideline for how to plan an activity. First and foremost, which of the four content areas is it going to? So it asks you on the sheet which one is this going to apply to. So it reminds you you need to have the content area addressed. And then if there's a theme, but there's a whole running list of things to consider and make sure you incorporate into the activity. I'm not going to go through the specifics on that because you're going to go through this as a group when you break out. At the end, though, on the back, it says debriefing. I want everyone to look at the back with me, because I gave you this other sheet about debriefing. Every activity that's, you know, beyond like a getting to know your name game should be debriefed. You need to have debriefing questions written in advance, so particularly in Step Up. That's one of the pieces. The kids plan an activity, great! But then they don't have any debriefing questions. And then they try to debrief it, and it flops. So planning the debriefing is almost as important as planning the activity itself. Because if you've got a really serious activity, and it's not debriefed properly, and the kids don't have the opportunity to get their feelings out or discuss it, it can actually change the dynamic of the camp. So it's really important to make sure you've got good debriefing questions written in advance. You don't have to stick to the debriefing questions the whole time. You can, you know, build off of an initial question and someone's response kind of thing. We did that a little bit today. You guys started talking, you went off kind of from what I had planned, but that was okay because you were talking about it and you were talking about how you felt and what you learned and
those kinds of things. So make sure debriefing is important, is added in. Then also the evaluation. You always want to evaluate your activities, and there's different ways to evaluate. Inside your box is materials for you to use. Don't write. There's scissors in there. Be careful.
Oh boy. This is your baby.
We were just talking about making babies.
Oh.
We were.
I'm just
saying babies. I'm just
a
baby.
Yeah, that came out wrong.
You have to come home.
You guys.
Why do I
have to?
You
really
it's now 8:17. You guys have until 8:45 to make some kind of protection for your baby out of these recyclable materials.
I hope you're doing this outside because your house is really nice.
You can go where we want.
Okay.
And then that's we're going to test your protection. There's a winner between your two teams because we're going to try to break your baby.
No.
So we want you to really try to protect your baby using whatever you want in those materials. Okay? Go.
Okay. All right.
Wrong with this egg.
Any idea why we did this activity? What on earth
teamwork.
Could this be? Teamwork.
I
good
have an
theory.
Idea.
What do you think, Anna?
Well, could the egg be a metaphor for something?
If you have a delicate situation, drop it off. Let's see what happens.
Could the egg be a metaphor for something else?
Remember,
what do you have to care for?
Everything we do in CISV has a purpose.
Children.
Okay, so that
children
was your baby.
Egos.
That was your delegate.
And
that's
how God. We all kept the baby alive.
You're dropping the baby off the roof, and you managed to keep the baby alive. So you're all going to be great leaders.
Yep.
So the point of this exercise, which I should let you come up with on your own, but I'll tell you, is that the parents... This is the most valuable thing to the parents. Their children is absolutely the most precious thing in their lives. And so they're very, maybe you would think they might overreact. You might think they're overreacting, but it's really, if you compare this to the most important thing in your life, this is it. So you need to be extra special careful with these kids and treat them as you would your own children.
So don't let the mean villain take them away and drop them off the roof.
There
like,
you go.
Because you just gave them to me. You didn't ask me. You questioned what you all was
we
doing.
We protected them. We
the
knew that they were ready
you
to go out and
trust
fly.
With them
I
throughout,
did.
Like, look
yeah.
at me, you know?
But
it's a
they
real
felt comfortable.
It's a really real responsibility, and I know you guys realize that. It's something to be really taken seriously. And I just have numerous examples of where people haven't and haven't really done a very good job. So just think about how you would feel if you were somebody's parents before you do anything, before you do or do not email them, before you take them to the hospital, before you treat them without telling the parents. Just think about how would I feel if this was my kid and react. Let that be your conscience. So that was the purpose of that activity, was thinking about the parents. And remember that they want communication. More communication is better. Always tell your parents, I can't guarantee I can communicate, because you never know what the internet capability is going to be. I've made that mistake. I said, I'm going to email you every day.
Oh, no.
We had no internet. It was really a problem. So don't ever do that.
Anyway, does anybody have any examples or suggestions or comments or experiences with that?
Plus, as leaders and staff, you're working. Like, yeah. All day, every day, you are working at camp. And you don't have time. It's like your full-time job. Just like the parents are at work, most of them. They don't have time to stop what they're doing at work to, you know, take care of it. It's hard. So that's another thing is you're too busy to call them every day. Like, that's, it's just because if you take away the time, if you're trying to contact the parents every day, that's taking away from the camp itself, too. So that's one way to explain it. But also, our parents have parent training, and in their training, that's explained to them that you guys are working, and you all have been trained. All the adults at camp, the staff, the leaders, everyone's had really good training, and to trust the training of CISV that your kids are going to be okay. So that's part of the parent training. Like, they're told all of that, too.
There were some complaints about the emergency money this past year. So you're given money that is collected from the parents before you leave for emergency purposes. And emergency purposes would be if the plane's delayed and you have to put up in a hotel room or some crisis happens, you have this extra money that you can use. And I guess some of the leaders used the money but then couldn't really account for how they'd spent it. And so we need you to keep careful, the receipts and be able to explain where this money went. That's a comment that came back. And then the other thing we need to talk about is post-CISV. So after CISV, you all know about the reentry overnight. And then there's also the junior branch, which we encourage everybody to get involved in. And the first thing that comes up after the reentry overnight is SRMC, which is Southeast Regional Mini Camp over Labor Day weekend, which you are invited and encouraged to go with your delegation. And then there's JB activities several a month. So everybody's encouraged to participate.
And the JB needs to have adult chaperones. They can't do them without having chaperones there. And so they're JB advisors and sponsors, but oftentimes they need extra people. They can't just do it on their own.
So. Yeah, and we're looking for JB advisors right now, I guess. Mm-hmm. So.
Mm-hmm. Back, so it's good to prepare the parents for how the children might be. Like, they might not want to share their stories right away, or they might not know how to talk to you about your stories. But also you, when you come back from your program, you need to prepare your personal friends and families with, like, you know, I might need a little downtime before I can, you know, you need to adapt and adjust back to the American culture, because where you're going to be is going to be so different from what you're used to at home. So prepare your friends and family, but also make sure that the parents of your delegates are aware that, you know, this could be a life-changing experience for their child, and they need to give them a little space and not be freaked out, you know, if their kids aren't talking to them right away. Some kids come home and talk nonstop about camp. Some kids come home and don't talk about it at all.
Visits with all the kids, I really tried to emphasize to the parents that, like, I didn't know what the communication was going to be like, but I made, like, my best effort to try to find out before camp. But I also, like, asked all of them, like, what would your ideal communication situation look like? So that I knew what they wanted. Even, and like, I tried to make them understand, like, okay, like, I know you want me to send, like, a picture of your kid every single day. And, like, I cannot promise that. But, like, then I knew, okay, like, that's what Kevin's parents want. And so, like, if I can make it happen for them, like, then I know what they would like. And so we kind of, like, and then with certain kids that had, like, medical issues, I talked to them and I was like, okay, what if this kid starts having this medical issue? How do you want me to handle that? Like, do you want me to call? Do you want me to just deal with it on my own and then debrief you after? And all the parents had, like, different responses to that question. And so I found it, because I was really stressed about taking the kids. And so that helped, like, calm me down, because it was, like, the parents, like, know how their kids operate, and they all had their own different expectations for me. And so it was good to, like, talk about it with them individually and know. And I kind of, like, have my little notebook and, yeah.
I found out my ideal communication situation is through WhatsApp. Mm-hmm. And you'll probably have to get it anyway. Everyone uses it internationally. It's free. All my camp chat groups are on WhatsApp, but I made the parents who didn't have it already download it, and then I had them all in a group for both of my camps, so I could just send out one message, saying something about each of the kids, and it went to everyone. I'd take some pictures. Sometimes at delegation time, I'd be like, oh, like, let me just take a picture of the delegation real quick. Like, oh, we're sitting on the grass. And then send it. One time I had them do a voice message where I just held down the voice button because we were kind of in a hurry. And I said, like, hey, I miss you. Can't wait to come home, you know? And had everyone just say a little something. And even if you don't have internet, which we didn't have very much internet, the nice thing on WhatsApp is you can put all these things on, and then as soon as you get internet, everything sends. So that was, and I'd also, like, if the kid, they could write a letter and I could take a picture of the letter and send it instantly without all this.
And, like, you know if they've read the messages, and then the parents, if they text you, they know if there's, the messages are, like, timestamped, so they know if you've read their text. So, like, if they text you and you don't respond, they will know, oh, it's just because, like, Hallie hasn't seen it yet, not because, like, Hallie saw my message and she's ignoring me. So, I agree. I think WhatsApp is a great way.
So do you feel comfortable about what forms you do? You guys both feel comfortable about the forms? Okay, good. So guess what? We're done early.